Thank you so much for joining us today. So there are all sorts of ways in which science and religion cross paths, sometimes harmoniously, sometimes not so harmoniously. And the case I want to focus on today is cases where science and religion seem to intersect with each other because we're offering scientific explanations for our religious belief. So in the last few years, there's been a lot of interest in particular in the brain bases and evolutionary bases of people's religious beliefs. To give you just one example of a recent headline, finding God in a seizure, the link between temporal lobe epilepsy and mysticism. There's been a lot of research along these lines, people relating different kinds of brain processes and neural processes to religious belief and religious experience. In this particular article, the author goes on to write that for people who experience temporal lobe epilepsy, their transcendent experiences are actually seizures. Another headline reads, "She thinks she believes in God. In fact, it's just chemical reactions taking place in the neurons in her temporal lobes." Another journalist describes one scientist's perspective like this: "Religious experience and belief in God are merely the results of electrical anomalies in the human brain." More generally, when we try to explain aspects of religious belief by appeal to the brain or genetic bases or basic psychological processes, it often seems like these are offered as some kind of threat or competition to that religious belief, as if they somehow challenge or debunk the religious belief. Now, it turns out that these so-called debunking arguments have a long history. So Freud famously wrote that religious ideas are illusions, fulfillments of the oldest, strongest, and most urgent wishes of mankind. He basically goes on to suggest that belief in God is the result of wishful thinking. He doesn't believe that this suggests that God, in fact, doesn't exist, but rather that this challenges our justification for believing in God. One way to think about this is that if you don't believe that wishful thinking is a reliable mechanism for arriving at true beliefs, then discovering that belief in God results from wishful thinking might give you some reason to challenge your basis for that belief, a reason to think you might be less justified in holding that belief. More contemporary arguments often appeal to evolution. So the idea is that if our religious beliefs can be shown to be the result of natural selection, whether they're the result of a biological adaptation or a side effect of biological adaptations, you might think that this gives us some reason to challenge our justification in those religious beliefs. Now, these questions that I've been raising are important philosophical questions that are controversial and have been debated by philosophers, the question being whether or not these kinds of scientific explanations for belief really do challenge or debunk the religious beliefs in any way. The question that I want to focus on today is the psychological counterpart to this question. Do people, in fact, treat scientific explanations for belief, or at least some scientific explanations for belief, as a challenge or a threat to their own religious beliefs, as the headlines that I just showed you might suggest is the case? So to explore this question, I had two collaborators, Dylan Plunkett, who will be a PhD student in psychology at Harvard, and my colleague at UC Berkeley, Laura Bushak, in the philosophy department. And in order to explore this set of issues, we conducted a set of studies that presented people with scenarios like the following. So I want to introduce you to Michael, our hypothetical agent here. And Michael is reading a website, and he comes across the following claim. The claim is that there is a God. Now, Michael hasn't actually given a lot of thought to this, but if asked, he'd probably say that he does accept this claim. But later, he reads the following in a reliable book. He reads that people are more likely to believe in God, this particular claim, if they frequently experience mini seizures in the ventral striatum cortex in their brain. Now, this is a scientific explanation that we completely made up, but you can see that this is based on the kind of popular coverage that you see about temporal lobe epilepsy or mini seizures being associated with a religious experience. And what we then asked people is what effect they thought learning this information would have on Michael's belief that there is a God. Is it going to make him more confident that God exists? Or is it going to make him less confident that God exists, as you might expect if this is treated as a debunking kind of explanation? Now, what we found was kind of interesting. If the scientific explanation takes the form I've shown you here, where we invoke something like mini seizures, then people said that this should make Michael less confident that God exists. But if we instead replace that particular scientific explanation with one that's perhaps more neutral or positive, we merely invoke type M neural activity, which again we made up, but the idea is that this doesn't imply the kind of abnormality, right, that you might think that seizures imply. In this case, we actually found that offering a scientific explanation for their religious belief made people think that Michael should become more confident in that belief. Now, we can show you this effect quantitatively as follows. So this is people's responses to how Michael's confidence in this belief should change in response to these explanations. When the explanation invokes mini seizures, a kind of abnormal brain basis for the belief, people become less confident. And when we invoke something like type M neural activity, people actually think that this should make him more confident. So just proffering a scientific explanation in and of itself doesn't seem to be threatening to the religious belief. Now, we didn't just look at religious beliefs here. We also considered scientific explanations for scientific beliefs, like the claim that humans evolved by natural selection, and scientific explanations for moral beliefs, like the idea that killing animals for human consumption is morally wrong. And we didn't only focus on these neuroscientific explanations. We also considered genetic explanations, developmental explanations, and cognitive explanations for various kinds of beliefs. And in all of these cases, what we varied was whether or not the scientific explanation invoked what you might think of as a normal process or an abnormal process. So I've given you one example already of mini seizures versus type M neural activity. We also described beliefs as resulting from a particular genetic mutation versus the absence of that mutation, as resulting from an attachment disorder or the absence of an attachment disorder, or as resulting from cognitive biases versus cognitive processes. And what we found across the board was that only some of these abnormal explanations were treated as debunking or somehow challenging people's beliefs in these domains. So here are what the data look like. And what you can see is that actually across the board for all of these explanations, offering a scientific explanation that appealed to normal processes led people, if anything, to become more confident. And the beliefs were only debunked or challenged in some of these cases where we offered abnormal explanations. Okay, so why does this matter? Well, one reason why I think this is interesting is because it tells us something about how people regard the relationship between scientific explanations and religious belief, and more generally, how they regard the epistemic bases for belief in different domains. But it also turns out that this actually has some interesting real-world implications. So it turns out that whether you are given a normal or an abnormal explanation trickles down into the way that people respond to potentially consequential real-world policy judgments. So in one of our studies, we presented people with either a normal or an abnormal neuroscientific explanation for either belief in God or for atheism. And we also asked them a variety of questions like the following. For the particular finding that they read about, we asked them how important they thought it was, whether it would be appropriate to teach that in science classes, whether it's appropriate to receive federal funding for that type of research, and so on. For lack of a better term, I'm going to collapse all of these kinds of questions into a measure of scientific trust, or how much they trusted these general scientific findings. And what we found is that people were least trusting of abnormal explanations for their own beliefs. Okay, so here's what the data look like. Remember that people were explaining, were seeing explanations for either belief in God or for atheism, and we also asked them about their own religious beliefs. So some of our participants were themselves theists or believers, and some of them were themselves atheists. And what you see is this sort of U-shaped pattern, where when you're explaining, receiving an explanation for your own belief, so an explanation for theism if you're a theist, an explanation for atheism if you're an atheist, you're going to show much less trust in a finding that invokes an abnormal process than a normal process. But when you're explaining the opposing belief, so this would be seeing an explanation for theism if you're an atheist, or seeing an explanation for atheism if you yourself are a believer, you see the reverse, where people now are less trusting of explanations that invoke a normal process as opposed to an abnormal process. Now, on top of that, we also found that across the board, believers were just less trusting than atheists of all of these scientific findings. So if we split up the data that I just showed you by whether or not people were themselves atheists versus theists, for the atheists, you again see the sort of U-shaped pattern I showed you before. For theists, you see the same sort of U-shaped pattern, but you'll also notice that all of these values are just much, much lower. Right? Across the board, the theists in the study were just much more skeptical or showed less scientific trust in these findings. Now, one implication of that is that when different sorts of people see a headline like the one that I just showed you here, even though they're all reading the same words and might be going on to read the same article, they're actually going to be understanding the scientific result and their implications very differently. People are going to understand the scientific findings differently, depending on whether or not they themselves are theists or atheists, but also depending on whether or not they take the neural explanation offered to suggest the operation of a normal or an abnormal type of process. These final results also hint at the idea that people who do and don't believe in God might differ more broadly in what we've been calling their views about the explanatory scope of science. That is, their views about whether or not scientific explanations can and should be offered for all aspects of human experience, not just religious beliefs, but also morality, love, conscious experience, and so on. And I've been exploring these issues with a PhD student in my lab named Sarah Gottlieb. And one of the things that we've done is try to develop a way to measure people's beliefs about the explanatory scope of science. So, for example, we give people items that they can agree with or disagree with. And people who endorse a broad scope of science would agree with statements like the following: that I think that all aspects of the human mind should be studied scientifically. People who endorse a narrow scope of science would agree with statements like, I think there are some subjects, like love and morality, which should never be studied by scientists, or there's something troubling about a purely scientific description of mental life. And what we found is that religiosity, by which I mean people's belief in God and the extent to which that they say religion is important in their own lives, is associated with having a narrower view about the explanatory scope of science. So quantitatively, what I'm showing you here is a correlation between people's religiosity and the extent to which they endorse a narrower scope for science. And you can see this is actually a very pretty strong correlation between these two factors. We also find that a narrower scope of science is associated with political conservatism, with greater disgust sensitivity, and with a tendency to engage in less reflective thought. So if you give people these sort of tricky word problems that can be answered either with an immediate intuitive gut reaction or with a more reflective or deliberative kind of response, we find that people who have the more kind of gut intuitive reaction are more likely to show a narrow scope of science. Now, importantly, if you take into account all of these additional associations between people's views about the scope of science and these factors, we find that their religiosity has an effect above and beyond these additional considerations. Right? So there seems to be a particularly close or special relationship between people's religious views and their views about the explanatory scope of science. So again, why does this matter in the real world, besides generally informing us about the close relationship between religious beliefs and views about science? One reason is that it turns out that our views about the scope of science actually relate to a host of bioethical judgments that again have real world and policy sorts of implications. So we find that people who endorse a narrower scope of science are also more likely to reject abortion, physician-assisted suicide, cloning, and stem cell research. And again, these relationships hold even if you factor in people's political beliefs and so on. Okay, so to sum up, I've been exploring the relationship between science and religion by focusing on one particular place where you see science and religion coming together, and that's in scientific explanations for religious belief. I've shown you some evidence that not all scientific explanations for religious belief are in fact treated as debunking. However, people do treat explanations that invoke abnormality as debunking. They're less trusting of such explanations, especially when they bear on their own beliefs. And this turns out to have implications for their views about those scientific findings, whether they should be taught in science classes, whether they're appropriate for federal funding, and so on. We've also seen that religious individuals differ from people who are less religious in terms of their interpretation of these scientific findings, the extent to which they trust them across the board. and that also people who are more religious tend to endorse a narrower scope for science. They're more likely to think that there are aspects of human experience that we can't and shouldn't approach scientifically. So the picture I want to leave you with looks something like this. On the one hand, we have a certain set of explanatory drives and preferences, right? There are certain kinds of explanations that we find more or less satisfying. We're very driven to find explanations for aspects of the world around us. And on the other hand, we have a set of religious beliefs and commitments, whether this is belief to a god of a particular type or belief in atheism. And my research and research by a lot of other people suggests that these two are closely related to each other. But that raises a lot of questions about the basis for this relationship. Is it that people's explanatory drives and preferences have a direct causal impact on their religious beliefs and commitments? Is it instead that people's religious beliefs and commitments have a direct causal impact on their explanatory drives and preferences? Or instead, do these have some kind of a common cause that accounts for why we see an association between these in the data that I've shown you and other people's data as well? Now, my own guess is that there's some reality to all of these causal connections, but I think the story is actually going to turn out to be somewhat more subtle than might be suggested. So at least to me, it's not really obvious why there would be a direct connection between simply the metaphysical belief that a god exists or not and these general explanatory drives and preferences. And a lot of the work that I've done also suggests that some of the plausible common causes for these, like general political views or general ideological views, probably don't account for all of this relationship because we find an association between these even when you factor out those influences. So I think the most promising place to focus is going to be on this particular arrow here. And it's not only because our explanatory drives and preferences might help us understand why we have religious beliefs at all, or why religious beliefs take the particular form that they do, but also because we've seen that people vary in their explanatory drives and preferences. And I think that variation that we see across individuals is going to help us understand some of the variation that we see in people's religious beliefs and commitments, and also why we often get such intractable kinds of tension at the interface of these debates, where you have people who might differ in their explanatory drives and preferences trying to come to some kind of agreement on these issues. So with that, thank you very much for your attention.